our next technical session on intellectual property rights by Sri Vidya Ravi Madam, Patent Associate, Gamlex Hermeneutics Private Limited, Pune. Now, I would like to introduce Sri Vidya Ravi Madam. Madam has been in the field of IPR for nearly 15 years after spending more than a decade in the pharmaceutical industry in the product development and quality assurance functions. She is currently heads the Pune operations of Gamlex Hermeneutics Private Limited, handling a crucial inventor facing role at CSIR NCL Pune. Amongst the other clients, she has experience in handling patents in the fields of chemistry, pharmaceuticals, fine chemicals, food and nutritional product. Combining her educational background in pharmaceuticals, a rich experience in the pharma industry with her knowledge and exposure to IPR, Sri Vidya regularly conducts training programs to postgraduate students of science and technology and is also a resource person to train patent examiners both in India and internationally. With this brief introduction, on behalf of all of us, I am requesting Sri Vidya Ravi Madam to address our audience on topic basics of IPR and planning an IPR portfolio. In continuation with the topic, proposals for the patent portfolio for an academic institution. Over to you, ma'am.
Good afternoon all, and thank you so much for that warm introduction. My greetings to each and every one of you on this World Health Day. As fellow pharmacists and healthcare professionals, this is a day that gives me pride and pleasure to meet each one of you and greet you on this occasion. Ma'am, do I have share screen rights?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much. Right, so we'll get going. I'm going to be with you for nearly the next 2 hours. And my topic would revolve around IPRs, intellectual property rights, particularly with a focus on patenting. I think you've had an excellent session by Shilpa Chaudhary, ma'am, a very interesting topic on modern pedagogy techniques. And ma'am has made it so interactive. She set a very high standard for me. Let me try and fulfill it at least to the extent possible. I hope the next 2 hours are valuable time spent by you in learning and sharing the ideas that I have towards planning an IPR portfolio for an academic institution. I understand that most of you are faculties also involved in research, not only as a teaching role. And therefore, this talk is catered around how best we can use the current facilities and the current schemes and the current initiatives taken by both the government and the foreign organizations towards creating a very valuable and a very commercially attractive IPR portfolio for an academic institution. So my talk will flow in this manner. I will give you a short introduction, and then I will take you through a short journey on the basics of intellectual property rights. Pardon me for spending some time on this. I think most of you would have already learned all these aspects of IPRs. It will only be a repetition for some of you who are also experts in this field. However, it will set the ball rolling and set the platform for the next topics that I'll be handling on IP management and IPR portfolio planning. So to basically create a scenario and a background to the last two topics that we'll be focusing on today, there'll be an introduction and the basics to be covered. However, the basics will be focused on pharmaceutical patenting activity rather than a general coverage of IPRs. So, whatever we create, okay, is what is eligible for protection in the form of intellectual property rights. So it is the creations of your mind, And what we mean by creativity is maybe each one of us sees something around us and then we start thinking about it. But we, you know, the out-of-box thinking and the different way in which you propose a solution and the different manners in which you execute that solution and doing it in a way that no one has ever suggested before or taking a path that no one has dared to take ahead of you, creating a new road and creating a new roadmap is what creativity is all about. And the expression of this creativity is in various modes. So many of us associate creativity with only expressing them in art forms. For example, you say you choreographed a dance piece, or you painted a piece of art, or you created a cinematographic work, or you took a beautiful photograph of the morning rising sun. However, to us as technologists, creativity is also the expression of an idea by way of a solution proposed to an existing problem. And that expression can be in the form of either a product or a process. So you come up with an idea and then you execute it in the form of a product or a process and new ways to solve existing problems or to come up with a very original idea, to come up with the original knowledge, which did not exist at all in the state of art, is the way we express our creativity. So you basically take up a very new or what in patenting terms is called novel or very unconventional approach. And you go about finding a solution, you propose it, and the proposal is what you submit it to the national IPR offices to seek protection for your creations. So creativity is the essential or the foundation for innovations. And innovations are new and new ideas that keep coming up. And those which qualify to be novel and other requirements of the Patent Act would qualify as patentable inventions. And the completely novel and unconventional approach that you take is what is the inventive activity you're pursuing, which is a result of the creativity that is there in your minds. So the core or the bottom of all pursuits of intellectual property is creativity. And through various acts that the governments and international organizations have proposed and the various treaties that have been signed through intergovernmental interventions and world organizations enable you to protect this creativity, whether you express it in the form of art creations or in the form of technological solutions. Both are eligible for protection. So if you're looking at typical technological solutions, then they are qualified as industrial creations or industrial rights that are bestowed on you, while the works of arts would be artistic creations and artistic protection of them through the non-industrial rights that are proposed. So you could have either approach and you would still be eligible for a protection. Having said that, I would like to emphasize at this stage itself that we should not have a restrictive or a limiting approach to intellectual property rights. And I'll elaborate on that in a few future slides in this very presentation. So what does these kind of intellectual property rights look as? And what is it that your creations are eligible to, have rights vested on them, to have duties and responsibilities and the liberties that are provided to you by various acts, to enjoy it as a property? So when we say property here, what we mean is it is something that you can own, something that has a certain value, something which you can either gift to somebody or sell, and something through which you can have commercial interactions and transactions. And also, yes.
Ma'am, could you please click on slideshow?
You have a problem, is it?
Slides will be visible.
Yeah, is it better now?
Yes, ma'am, yes.
Yeah, sorry about that. Yeah. Yeah, so coming back to the property aspect of intellectual property rights. So when you're talking of property, as I told you, it is something that you can own. Your name will be assigned, you know, or put in the document as the owner. You can, you know, find a value for it. You can evaluate, you can determine whether it is saleable. You have the right to sell it. You have the right to gift it. You have the right to give it off to someone. Or you have even the right to mortgage it and avail of loans and such kind of financial requirements that you may have. So it is in that sense similar to what we call tangible properties, which are, you know, those kind of properties which you can actually see. So, you know, typically when you say property, your mind would go to, say, a flat or a piece of land or a bungalow or shares or jewelry or, you know, automobiles and things like that. However, intellectual properties are intangible properties. They are not something that you can obviously see. However, there will be a piece of document which declares you to be the rightful owner of that particular property, which will be issued by the government or the national intellectual property rights offices. And they will enjoy the same features that a tangible property would enjoy. So though there are differences between the two, nevertheless, this is also a property and it rests on you rights that are similar to tangible properties. So coming back to how your intellectual outputs translate into various forms and what are the particular acts and particular forms that are protected in India. This is particularly relevant to India and the statutes and laws that are enacted and governed by the local national government. So if you express your idea in the form of an artistic, cinematographic or any other such artful form, then you would enjoy what is called a copyright protection. So a copyright is basically a protection given to you for the expression of the idea, the way in which you have expressed. So it is typically literary, artistic, cinematographic, and dramatic works that enjoy copyright protection. And this is protected in India by way of the Copyright Act 1987. If you express your idea in terms of an innovation or an invention, that is a product or a process which solves a problem existing in the state of art, then it is protected by means of the Patent Act 1970, and you get a patent granted for it. On the other hand, if your creativity is expressed in terms of a name or a brand name or a logo that you create, which basically associates the name with a particular quality and identity of a product, then that particular name or that particular logo will be protected under the Trademarks Act 1999. And this currently, after all the last amendments, covers both the trademark as well as the service marks. So if you can recollect, in the last couple of decades, we have seen a huge surge in the service industry. So the service industry also wants to maintain protection for their you know, brands and for their logos. And therefore that aspect is also covered in the Trademarks Act of 1999. If your creativity is expressed in terms of the two-dimensional or the three-dimensional characteristics of a product, okay, so you're basically working on the appearance of a product. Say you design a new piece of necklace or you change the way in which your cell phone looks. Okay, so these are articles that are well known. They are not new by themselves. They are not new products. However, you are changing the way it is viewed by a customer or a client. So those aspects which affect the appearance of a product, so they can affect the shape, the size, the color combinations, or even the three-dimensional aspects of it. And such aspects are protected by way of the design. And it is the Designs Act 2000 which gives you the protection. And finally, if you want to keep all data that you've generated confidential, you don't want it to be leaked into the public domain, you think that it is something that you have found out, which is very valuable. However, it cannot be brought out into public domain for various reasons. Maybe you think that once it is disclosed, it is very easy for somebody to copy, and you don't have the resources to prevent that kind of copy. Or you think that it is not eligible for a patent protection. It is a kind of subject matter which is not allowed anywhere in the world to be protected. Then you can maintain it as confidential information, or it can be maintained as a trade secret. And that in India is protected under the common laws, the IPC, the CPC, and the CRPC. We do not have an exclusive law enacted for trade secrets, unlike you see for trademarks, copyright, patents, or designs. So having said this, there are a few more formal intellectual property rights, such as the geographical indications and the protection of integrated circuits. But since they don't impact us directly as pharmacists, so I've not gone into the depth of it in this particular session. However, if any of you have any queries regarding that, please feel free to pose them, and I'll try and reply to them to the best of my ability. So moving on to patents in particular, okay, what are the requirements to make an invention patentable according to the Indian Patent Act? And what is it that the patent examiner will look for in your patent application? So the first requirement in the Patent Act is novelty. And novelty means anything new, anything hitherto undisclosed, unknown, or not available in public domain. That is, when the patent examiner searches in any publicly available database, or he looks at any publicly available piece of literature or information, he should not get access to this particular invention. If that is the case, then you pass the test on novelty. And usually the patent examiner will look for a single piece of document that discloses all elements of your invention. So what that translates to is that if you have published your work before you patented, then you would have probably disclosed all aspects of your invention in that particular document. So the slogan of patent first and then publish, or patent first and then collaborate, discuss, and take projects ahead should be the bottom line in case you want to maintain the novelty of your invention. Otherwise, it is very rare that an invention will not pass the test of novelty. We all very well know how technology works, how different people have different approaches to a problem. And even in very, very crowded areas of technology, where there are several people who are working, several researchers putting their minds into solving some problems or issues, even there, each one of us will not come up with an absolutely same or matching solution to a problem. Therefore, it is extremely rare that your invention will not enjoy novelty. And the one document that can destroy it is your own publication, or if you have put up a blog on your website, or if you have discussed it with someone and they have reported that in public domain, or you have given access to a thesis which is published in a public forum like the university's website or some such platform. So unless an event like this occurs, you will generally be able to establish novelty of an invention. The second criteria that the patent office will look for in your invention is industrial applicability or utility. So whatever invention you come up with should have a certain usefulness, and it should be eligible for being applied on an industrial scale and produced and provided to the market in quantities that they need it. So this is a very critical requirement. And if you're looking at pharmaceutical technology related patents, almost all of them would enjoy utility or industrial applicability. The third and the little gray area where most of us fumble and most of us face challenges in terms of getting a patent granted or convincing the patent examiner that your invention is eligible for a patent protection is satisfying the requirement of inventive step, or otherwise also termed as non-obviousness. Now, what does this mean? This means that the invention as a whole should not be obvious to a person skilled in the art. Now, what do you mean by a person skilled in the art? Now, if we are looking at inventions in the field of pharmaceuticals, then another pharmacist who has, you know, background in terms of education, experience, and exposure to current technology and literature available in this field, to the inventor, such a person is a person skilled in the art. So art basically means the same area of technical subject or technical domain. So when we say he is a person skilled in the art, he is a person who has similar skill sets and similar educational and experiential background as that of the inventor. So if it is obvious to such a person, then your invention does not satisfy the requirement of inventor step, and therefore it is obvious and is therefore not patentable. Now, how does the patent office determine this? For this criteria, they are at liberty to combine various pieces of prior art. Okay, so they can basically look at two or three or even more pieces of prior documents, and those are documents which have been in public domain prior to the date of your patent filing, and they can combine those documents in the sense that they can say document one talks of a certain feature of your invention, document two talks of another feature of your invention, a document three discusses and motivates you to go in a certain direction to solve the problem in the prior art. And therefore, when you combine this, you arrive at the invention. Now, if you get a comment like this from the patent office, then what can you do? You can rebut. You are at liberty to do it as an inventor. You can rebut the patent examiner's comments. You can provide a reply to the objections that he has raised by stating that, yes, document one did say this. However, it did not imply this aspect of my invention. Document two suggested some aspect of my invention, but there is no teaching in document two that says that if I follow a certain teaching from document two, I will arrive at these features of my invention. So it is basically a dialogue that you have with the patent examiner, and you convince him that your invention does indeed have an inventive step. And if you're able to convince him, then you are certainly passing all these three criteria, and this will result in the grant of a patent. So I am going to walk you through some aspects of the Patent Act which are relevant to our session today. And then we will take up an example of how to determine patentability so that the aspects of novelty, inventive step, and industrial application, as well as the next aspects of patentable invention that I'm going to discuss, will become amply clear to you. So we'll have a small exemplary session at the end of the next few slides that will clear whatever doubts you have in your mind. So kindly hang on there, and then we'll come back to this aspect again. Having said that, you have to qualify for those three basic criteria. Another patentable filter that is there in the Indian Patent Act and that is relevant to each one of us as pharmacists is this section, which is called Section 3 of the Indian Patent Act. And Section 3 basically lists all those inventions which are not eligible for patent protection in India. Okay, so these are inventions that are not patentable, and this is Section 3 of the Indian Patent Act. And there are several sections here which are extremely relevant to us as pharmacists, and there are some of them which are particularly relevant only to pharmacists. So we will quickly run through these, because understanding these will make it very important for us when we discuss how a portfolio can be created in an academic setup. So Section 3A is the first clause, which says frivolous and inventions contrary to natural laws are not patentable in India. So typically, if you look at, an example given here is that of a perpetual time machine. That is something so contrary to natural laws of time going by. And therefore, if you have invented a time machine, then according to Section 3A of the Indian Patent Act, even if it is novel, inventive, and industrially applicable, this will be the clause that is cited to reject this particular patent application. Moving on to section 3B, those inventions that are contrary to public order or morality, which are prejudicial to human, animal, or plant life or health, or even prejudicial to the environment which is around us, will not be provided patent protection. So, you know, suppose you are coming up with an invention to, you know, have a novel material which can potentially be an explosive, then the patent office can reject it on the basis that it is contrary to public order, because it is also prejudicial to human, animal, or plant health in the country. Therefore, this can be the basis of rejecting your application. The third section is section 3C, which is mere discovery of scientific principle, abstract theory, living thing, or non-living substances. Now, this is very relevant to us as pharmacists. Say, for example, you find that, you know, you identify and you validate a new target that is there to, you know, treat a therapy, and you have drugs that are acting on that particular target, and you are able to elicit the desired activity. Then will that target be patentable? That will be your first primary question. Now, the you know, counter question to that is, if the target is, say, for example, an enzyme or a particular mechanism that occurs in a biological system, say in a human body, then that will be the discovery of that particular part or that enzyme or that particular mechanism or that particular gene. Then such kind of discoveries will not enjoy patent protection in accordance with Section 3C of the Indian Patent Act. So this is very relevant for us to understand that it will not be easy for us to patent these kind of discoveries. Patents are granted for inventions and not for discoveries. Similarly, if you isolate a microorganism and it has excellent industrial application in terms of the quantum yield that it provides in, say, a fermentation process, then you certainly have a novel, inventive, as well as industrially applicable subject matter. However, the core of the subject matter is the organism, which is a discovery. You have basically isolated it from a natural source, and therefore that particular discovery will not enjoy patent protection in view of Section 3C. Moving on to Section 3D, this is completely and solely only for the pharmaceutical technologists. Mere discovery of a new form of a known substance, or a new property of a known substance, or new use of a known substance, or a machine, or an apparatus is not patent protectable in India unless you show that this new form has increased or enhanced therapeutic efficacy. Okay, so this has been the subject matter of even a long drawn litigation between Novartis and the Indian Patent Office. I will discuss it at one of the later slides in detail. However, the court, particularly, eventually it went up to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court opined that you can grant patent protection for discoveries of new forms of known substance. However, they will be protectable only and only if they have enhanced therapeutic efficacy. And the court even went to the extent of stating that when you are demonstrating enhanced therapeutic efficacy, then you actually need to show it in terms of clinical data in those subjects in which you are saying that there will be an enhanced efficacy. So this is a real challenge for pharmacists such as us, where we think that when we invent something, the first thing you would want to do is to file it in the patent office so that you can later on publish and collaborate and so on and so forth. However, the court is now asking for clinical data, which is a long-run process in terms of generation and confirmation that indeed there is therapeutic efficacy enhancement. So this is really a challenge, and we will discuss the finer aspects of it later. But to continue with Section 3D, for the sake of this particular clause, the Act very clearly says that salts, esters, polymers, enantiomers, okay, crystalline forms, pure forms, isomers, complexes, combinations, derivatives, analogs are all considered new forms of a known substance. Therefore, there is a lot of restriction that is applied on what is patentable under Section 3D. So So to you, it may appear that only new chemical entities are patentable, and their, you know, derivatized or analogous or salt, ester, ether, prodrug, those kind of forms are not patentable. However, the caveat is that if you are able to demonstrate enhanced efficacy, then you can certainly, most certainly, be eligible for a patent protection. Now, the relevant aspect here is not only of new forms, but also new use. And this has come into a lot of highlight in view of the current pandemic situation we are facing, where most of the therapies that are being offered are of repurposed drugs. And repurposed drugs are not eligible for patent protection in India because new use of a known substance or a new property of a known substance is not eligible for patent protection. So if you're looking at either remdesivir or chloroquine or hydroxychloroquine or any of those drugs, then their purpose of treating the current coronavirus will not enjoy patent protection in India. So going further, mere admixture, again, a combination of two drugs or a combination of a drug with various excipients or combination of a drug with unique excipients to provide typical profiles or typical release of the drug and so on and so forth will not enjoy patent protection in India unless you show synergistic data to support the admixture. So if you're just mixing a couple of ingredients and they're both performing the way they would if they were individually administered, then that is not eligible for patent protection. However, you bring them together and you see a synergy, then you are certainly having a patentable invention. Mere arrangement, rearrangement, or duplication of known devices. The example given here is that of a torch and an umbrella. So if it is raining, you open the umbrella, it prevents you from getting wet. The torch gives you the light if it's a dark area. So each are performing their own functions, and you're just, I rearrange them together, or you have brought them together in a single device. So even if you have combined them in this manner and they have huge benefits in terms of client requirements, nevertheless, they will not enjoy patent protection. Moving on further, method of agriculture or horticulture, again, not patentable in India. Then processes or methods for medical, surgical, curative, or prophylactic, including diagnostic and therapeutic. Such kind of treatment methods are not eligible for patent protection in India. Okay, so they can be even to treat animals or humans. They can be to cure them of a disease or to enhance their commercial value. So if you're, for example, treating a sheep to enhance the wool production, then such a method of treatment of the sheep to enhance the commercial value of the sheep will not be eligible for a patent protection in India. The next section, again, of relevance to us as pharmacists, plants, animals, seeds, varieties, species, of course, not patentable if they are synthesized by conventional biological processes. But what is of interest to us is the exception where they say that those microorganisms which are invented by non-conventional, biotechnology-oriented processes will be eligible for patent protection. So if you have bioengineered a microorganism and that microorganism is able to do some industrial activities which otherwise a conventional organism is not able to perform, or this is able to do it in an enhanced manner, such kind of microorganisms themselves, even though they are living beings, are eligible for patent protection. There was a very famous case around this in the US called the Diamond versus Chakravarti. I'm sure some of you are aware of it. However, just to give you a very small brief, basically Chakravarti designed an organism which he biotechnologically engineered such that it can degrade plastic. And though the patent office initially rejected the claim on the organisms, they eventually approved it because it was not an organism that was naturally occurring. It was actually synthesized or bioengineered by this particular inventor, and therefore it was given patent protection. So such kind of inventions are eligible for patent protection. So moving on, business methods, algorithms, computer programs are not eligible for patent protection in India. Literary, dramatic, musical, or artistic work can enjoy copyright but not patent, schemes of rules of playing games, mental acts, not patentable, presentation of information, not patentable, topographic of integrated circuits, not patentable, but there is another act for protecting them, so we can go and apply under that act and seek protection. This has become of importance to us because many of us are working in the field of diagnostics or in the field of devices, and you may have typical integrated circuits and algorithms working to, you know, give a particular diagnosis or to give a particular therapy. So you should have an idea of where to go and seek protection when you have such kind of creations which are part of your IPR portfolio. Therefore, I'm emphasizing these parts of the non-patentable section 3 of the Indian Patent Act as well. And finally, and one of the most important clauses which has impacted the pharmaceutical world in a big way is traditional knowledge by itself is not patentable in India. There is an entire set of guidelines that has been issued by the patent office for pharmaceutical inventions, biotechnological inventions, and traditional knowledge-based inventions. And what particularly, if you invent, will not be eligible for protection has been issued. So you can go and visit the Indian Patent Office website under their publication section. These guidelines are available and you can update yourself. So having said all this and having, you know, spoken about the novelty inventive step and industrial applicability requirements, okay, with all these sections which are so relevant to pharmaceutical technologies, the doubt that may come in your mind is, then what is it that can enjoy patent protection in India? So I'm going to just give you a very brief example of this before I move on. And the innovative way in which the applicant dealt with his invention and eventually got a patent granted. So the case study that I'm going to present here is, I hope each of you recollect that recently we have been seeing a new type of water purification device for domestic use that is being advertised by none other than Madhuri Dixit. So she comes on the screen, on your TV screen, that actually tells you that now your water has the goodness of all the valuable herbs that your grandmother used to tell you to have. So it has the goodness of clove, it has the goodness of tulsi, it has the goodness of cinnamon and so on and so forth, ginger and whatnot and whatnot. So if you had to traditionally look at knowledge that was available in public domain, then we all know that clove and tulsi and ginger and all has its own benefits when it is taken. So they have some antibacterial properties. They also have other properties in terms of prevention of cough, prevention of stomach disorders and so on and so forth. Then how did this particular invention obtain patent protection? That is a doubt that will come to you in your mind. You will think that, you know, it is completely part of traditional knowledge. It is an obvious invention in view of the fact that all this knowledge is available in various fora through public domain, available publications and books that are referred to us to learn about these kind of traditional knowledge aspects. So it may be novel that a water purifier has these kind of features. It is certainly industrially applicable because there are several water filters that are made and sold by this particular company. But it is an obvious invention according to you, which is the conclusion even I had. And it is also falling under section 3P of the Indian Patent Act and therefore does not qualify for a patentable invention. Now, considering all this in the background, I would like to tell you what exactly this company did to get a protection for this particular water filter. What they did was they actually created a cartridge. So they have a product patent around this cartridge. And this cartridge is what they have protected. And it is this particular cartridge which contains either the extracts or the actual biological parts of these particular plants whose features they are particularly claiming in the water filter. So a cartridge which has, say, a tulsi extract, an extract of clove or extract of ginger and so on and so forth, turmeric and all that, is what is claimed by this AquaGuard company. And they protected that cartridge. and then they protected a water filter which has that cartridge, and therefore the kind of benefits that you get out of the water, that is the result of the operation of the water filter. So it was a very innovative product that had a huge market value, which had the potential to be rejected by the patent office in terms of obviousness and section 3T. However, the scientists at AquaGuard, the technologists who were working there, were able to overcome all these aspects and design and present a cartridge that overcomes all these negative aspects. So it is a very essence of creativity that has resulted in a patent protection of such a water purifier. So this is just an example that I wanted to demonstrate to all of you, that in spite of all these stringent requirements, you may think that it is way too difficult to work around, but it is your creativity which will actually win the race. Eventually, the patent office will have to acknowledge that you now have a patentable invention and will have to grant you a protection. So typically, what is patentable in the pharmaceutical world? So coming back to our own area, new chemical entities, new biological entities, new molecular entities, certainly eligible for patent protection. From that, whatever you identify as active pharmaceutical ingredient will enjoy a product patent, a process of making it, a formulation, dosage forms of that, dosage forms which have particular release profiles, novel drug delivery systems, all of them are eligible for patent protection. Me too derivatives, if you look at, you know, the NIP series, for example, imatinib, trilotinib, sorafenib, sunitinib, each one of them has unique structures. They are not obvious inventions and therefore do enjoy patent protection. However, as I said earlier, new use, repurposing, not eligible for patent protection in India. So you still have a huge ground to play. You still have a lot of innovation that you can do. You still have a lot of inventions that you can seek patent protection for. So typically looking at one of the examples of a portfolio, this is a multi-header. All of us know of this product. Many of you may have even used or seen your near and dear ones using. What I'm trying to convey through this slide is, while this particular multi-header has a patent around it, do not restrict a particular invention that you have come up with to one particular intellectual property right that you may seek. Okay, so if you look at this particular product, it has a patent for its novel and inventive features. The brand name Multi-Healer is protected under the Trademarks Act. The design or the features, the external features, those features that are visible to your eye in terms of the 2D, 3D characteristics of this particular product are protected through a design protection. There is some aspect of trade secret or know-how also maintained here in terms of the particle size of the drug which is put into the Multi-Healer, such that it is easily available in 30 optimal doses by the simple operation of the multi-healer. So there is a know-how or a confidential information aspect of this invention which is kept as trade secret. And then the tray, the package insert or the information leaflet that is provided along with this particular multi-healer, providing instructions to the user, enjoys copyright protection since it is a work of literature. So typically, you should look at any creation that you make in various angles and perspectives and decide and determine all the possible protection it is eligible for. I'll quickly take you through this slide because this is a process of obtaining patent protection in India. And I'm going to do this just so that you understand what is the process that is involved with regard to you as an inventor and your interaction with the government, which will issue the patent to you via the patent office. So initially, when you have an invention, you will do what is called a search, which in typical patent terms is called a prior art search. As I told you, art is that particular field of technology. So any document that is available prior to the date of invention will affect the novelty and inventive step of your documents. So you will determine whether your invention is patentable by way of a prior art search. And then you will file what is called a complete or a provisional patent application. Now, what is the difference in these two? Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. Satish, sir, you have a question. Satish, sir? Hello?
Yes,
you have something to ask? You can unmute and ask.
Hello.
Hello, yes, sir.
Ask, ma'am, what is the actual process for patent grant?
That is what is going to be explained to you by way of the slide, sir.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, so once you have done a search, you have determined the patentable aspects of your invention, then you can file what is called a complete patent application, or you can opt for what is called a provisional patent application. Just to elaborate on the difference between these two styles of application, you can apply for a provisional patent application if you think that you have a patentable invention. However, there are some aspects of the invention which needs more experimental work to be done. And you have certain more optional or certain more finer aspects of the invention that have to be explored at the laboratory. However, there is also a race in terms of time as to who is the first inventor, because anybody filing before you will have a prior date than you. Therefore, if you have further work to be done, and you're also working in those areas of technology where there are several researchers who are researching and applying for patent protection, then once you have initial results and a fair degree of confidence that your invention is working, and you have experimental data to support it, though they are preliminary in nature, then you apply for what is called a provisional patent application. So you write about the invention, and you apply it at the patent office, and you get a date of application. However, what you have not done here is also covered the claims of the invention, because you have not still worked all the aspects of the invention. So the Patent Act and the Patent Office actually give you 1 year's time to work on the finer aspects of your invention, and then move from the provisional and file a complete application within a year of the provisional patent application. Okay. Now, once you have applied, the patent office mandatorily publishes your application at the end of 18 months. Kindly remember that patent is a document that is always placed in public domain. Okay, it is not kept secret like a trade secret. Now, there is a provision to seek early publication by way of paying additional fee also. Once a patent is published, the patent office will start the process of examining the patent. However, you have to request for it. Now, you can request for expedited examination by paying additional fee, or you can go through the regular queue of the examination. And then the patent office will issue an examination report. You can write back to the patent office, replying to the objections they have raised, and the examination will result in either the grant or the refusal of the patent. If it is granted, then the patent office again publishes the granted patent as well. Now, kindly remember that even before the grant or refusal, by way of pre-grant or by way of post-grant, 1 year after the approval of the patent, and at any time up to the 20-year tenure of the patent is eligible for being opposed or revoked. Okay, so it is a legal document which has the technological aspects of your invention. Therefore, it is termed as a techno-legal document, and it is eligible for all those actions that a legal document is eligible for, that somebody can oppose it, somebody can say that it is invalid, and it can go into court proceedings, and the court will eventually decide on whether it is valid or whether the opposition is not having strong grounds to make it invalid. So these are the various aspects of a patent filing and its maintenance over the entire 20-year tenure or period of the patent. So Moving on further, just to give you distinctions in terms of various intellectual property rights, when it comes to copyrights or trademarks versus patents and designs, okay, and drawing parallels because we need to understand these finer aspects a little. So when you're talking of copyrights and trademarks, okay, you start with disclosures or expressing. So copyright is a way in which you're expressing your idea. So you'll actually express it in terms of either a document or a poem, or you'll make a movie or whatever. So you're actually expressing it. And you can apply for its registration anytime. Even without registration, copyrights are eligible for being held in your name. So if you recollect the first slide where I put in the title of this particular talk, I had put a C around it. That is because I have sought copyright protection for this particular presentation. So I have prepared this copy of this presentation a few days back. However, I'm seeking copyright protection only now. It can be done at any possible timeline after creation. And there are common laws available in case there is plagiarism of your, you know, artistic material or literature. And you will get relief under these particular acts of Copyright Act or Trademark Act. For infringements. Infringement means somebody copying your work. You can get relief of it only if you're registered. But copyright itself, okay, is eligible for protection even if it's not been registered formally at the copyright office. Trademark, however, you have to apply to the trademark office for registration, and you will certainly get relief if somebody is infringing your trademark under the Trademarks Act. So this is with regard to copyright and trademark. As against patents and designs, where you have to first file and then only bring it out as a disclosure. So if you disclose it prior to filing, then you are killing the novelty of your own design or that of your invention. So you will get protection, you'll get relief in terms of infringement or injunction only if you have applied for protection and only after it is registered by those respective offices. So patents and designs to be maintained confidential till the time you have applied for registration. However, copyrights you can express even if you're not registered at all. So these are the fine distinctions between these various IPRs, and they will impact all your working when you're trying to create a portfolio around your creative works. That is why we have tried and brought out these distinctions to you upfront itself. So in case there is any queries here, let me know. Otherwise, I also want to know whether you want to take a break or should I continue? And if the ma'am who is convening the session can let me know, I can accordingly proceed.
Please continue. No problem, madam.
Okay, fine. All right, I'll do that.
Yes, ma'am.
Since we started a little late, is it okay if I continue without the break?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, madam. Yes, yes. No issue.
Okay, fine. Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you for that. Okay, so having spoken about all those formal forms of IPRs, I also want to bring in a little focus on the quasi-intellectual property rights. That is those IPRs which are not formally protected by various acts. Like for example, when he spoke about confidential information, I told you that there is no particular act in India. So if you're looking at industry in general and pharma industry in particular, we do have several IPRs that are created, but which are not formally registrable. So some of them are listed here. So you have data exclusivity, which is that data that you generate when you do clinical trials. You have brand loyalty or goodwill that you generate as an organization. You have a house name, you have client list, you have reports from market intelligence or management practices. You have know-how that you have created for some particular technologies that you work for. You have test methods, you have specifications that are particularly in-house and additional to what the pharmacopoeia specifies. All these are form form part of the quasi intellectual property rights, and they will certainly be part of the IP portfolio that you create. Okay, so you don't have to look at these in isolation as IPRs. Rather, you need to look at them as a bouquet of, you know, various flowers that come together and form the beautiful bouquet that you buy. Similarly, you have all these various formal and intellectual property rights that come together to form a part of your portfolio. So moving on further, that was all part of the basic IPRs. I now come to the intellectual property management aspect of this talk. And this is something that we have compiled specifically for faculties and innovation councils that are run by various universities and organizations nowadays. And these are very critical in terms of understanding the various aspects of IP. While we as scientists usually associate ourselves only with the generation of IP, but managing it to make it reach its logical conclusion of finding and eventually, you know, becoming a commercially marketed product is what IP management is all about. And I'll spend the next few minutes talking about this aspect. So why in the first place should you seek IP protection at all? Okay, so most of us, when we work on very innovative aspects of the, you know, technologies that we are involved in, eventually end up having a very good publication in a peer-reviewed journal. That to us is a logical conclusion. Some of you, of course, have students whom you are guiding, you're mentoring, and then they have their dissertation or thesis as the conclusion of the work that they do. And even that eventually, you know, results in a publication and a degree to be obtained at the end of the process. So, you know, if you are looking at why you should seek IP protection before you publish your work, then these are some of the reasons. You know, they can be personal, they can be related to our society, and eventually to the national goals of the country. So one of the salient features of seeking IP protection is for you to be recognized as a creative contributor and to contribute to the particular technical field that you're working in. As a passionate researcher that all of you are, I'm sure publication is giving you a lot of recognition, but the creative aspects of your work is best recognized by way of a patent protection. Therefore, that can be one of the reasons why you should seek IP protection. But the more important reason is also because an IP will actually end up having a commercial value. So to valorize your creation, to have a tag put onto it in terms of an financial, you know, transaction that can be had, to economically benefit from the creation that you have done, you need to seek IP protection. Therefore, valorization of your creation is possible only when you have IP protection to it. It can be any form of IP. I'm not particularly saying this is for patents. Even a design, even a trademark has huge amount of value. I'm sure each of us know how valuable a brand name like Crosin, or for that matter, Derifilin, or any of these enjoy, Corex, or any of them enjoy. So these are the ways in which your creations can be valorized. Then coming to the benefit that you are, you know, providing to the humanity and society at large. Okay, if you have valuable solutions, then they will benefit humanity and society. So unless you have IP and somebody commercializes it, eventually what you're creating otherwise will just remain in your publications. So if you have to take your creations to a logical conclusion of a marketable product, then a commercial entity will come to you only if you have sought IP protection for it. Therefore, if you want your work to benefit humanity and society, and eventually to create wealth for the nation, then you will have to seek IP protection for it. And why I've also put this bullet on your duty as a citizen is because it is enshrined in our constitution itself that each one of us should have a spirit of inquiry instilled in us. We certainly have it because as researchers, we do a lot of inquiry mentally and eventually bring it out as products and processes, as solutions to various problems and issues. So to fulfill that particular duty enshrined in our constitution also, it is our duty to seek and protect the IP that we create. So these are the reasons as to the why aspect of IPRs. Now the how aspect of it, you know. So how would you go about actually creating IPRs, particularly patents? The first and the foremost aspect is that you identify a market need. Okay. I would like to point out at this stage that this is not particularly an industry that is seeking IPR. It can be even in an academic setting. Even as an academic researcher, you, I'm sure, are looking at market needs. You have collaborators who come and tell you that there is a problem in the market and they're looking for solutions for it. So you are very well aware of this. Maybe you're not only formally looked at it from this perspective. So I'm just trying to bring that out in you in a more obvious form. So the first and the foremost step that you will undertake is to identify a particular market need. Once you have done that, you're going to look at literature to see what are the various ways in which that need has been fulfilled. Now, while most of us look at publications, I'm sure nowadays all of you are also looking at patent literature. You're seeing what are the technologies that have been proposed and protected through patents for fulfilling the market need. Mind you, most of the patents that are granted or being applied for are eligible in public domain through free databases. So it's not a very, very tough challenge to seek and review patent literature. It is all available. Even Indian Patent Office website nowadays gives you full text of the patent applications and granted patents, and it is a freely available database. So this is not something that is a huge challenge as it was a few years back. Okay. Once you have looked at literature, you're going to ascertain the gaps and the drawbacks in existing solutions. You will propose your own solution. You will work this own new solution in the lab to generate data and to check whether indeed the results that you have got is fulfilling that particular solution. Once you have done that, the next logical step is either to, you know, go and speak with your IPR cell people in your university or to seek the opinion of an IP attorney and then apply for patent protection on receipt of queries from the patent office or any other, you know, communication that has been done to you. Submit a response to it promptly ahead of the deadline so that you don't miss out on any particular timeline that has been provided in the Patent Act. And then eventually you're getting a patent granted in your name. So it is a process that you need to follow the moment you think that a particular IPR has been identified. Now, while this has been elaborated for patent, it is almost similar if you have a trademark or a design protectable invention, or for that matter, a copyright or any such IPR. So once you follow this process, you have an IPR that has been granted in your name. At this stage, I would like to tell you or highlight one aspect is, once you have applied for patent protection, after that, you're free to publish, you're free to submit your thesis and defend it in the Viva. You're free to seek collaborators. You're free to seek external service providers whom you may require for some particular characterization or animal study or any such aspect. So the process of patenting, which takes a few months to a few years, okay, is not going to prevent you from doing the following activities. So once you have applied, the liberty is already provided in the Patent Act itself. So please do not feel inhibited that only on grant of a patent you can take a project ahead. Once you have applied for a patent, you can even actually start marketing your IPRs and seek commercial partners at that stage itself. So this is how you go about obtaining IPRs. Now, to manage this particular intellectual property obtainance process, a few useful pointers are presented here. It is generally good to acquire a certain fundamental knowledge. This is true of any field that you work in. It is not only IPRs. This is true if we have to do any financial transaction or we go out and start looking at a very different domain in which we want to seek kind of, you know, knowledge or expertise. So it is similar even for IPRs. You can take the assistance of techno-legal experts or IP attorneys. Mind you, nowadays, a lot of these services, you know, the initial meetings and all that are actually conducted pro bono or for free by many of the experts. the patent office themselves also provide you service providers who come at a very nominal cost. So money to me is not at all a problem. Financial constraints are not at all there. I will just show you in the next few slides how many financial facilities are available if you want to seek patent protection, not only in India, but even if you want to pursue foreign filings. So that is the reason why I would say that you should actively seek the assistance of a technolegal expert or an IP attorney, because they are the ones who are working in this field and who best understand these aspects very well. So you understand very well where your invention stands vis-a-vis relevant prior art. It is very important to understand this, because this is what will help you to overcome the objections that can be potentially raised by the patent offices. Then once you have an IP attorney who is working on your patent application, if he shares a draft with you, my suggestion to you is to very critically examine the draft, similar to how you would, you know, prepare and review a manuscript that you want to submit to a journal. Similarly, review the patent draft, understand what they're trying to convey and what are the claims that they are making. The claims are that part of the patent application which provide you protection from potential copiers or infringers. Therefore, whether your claims are adequately protecting the scope of your invention, whether they are distinguishing your invention adequately to bring out the novel and inventive aspects, whether they are moving away from the potential prior arts that are there to the invention, all these aspects should be kept in mind when you're reviewing the patent draft and finalizing the claims of the patent application. When you're doing this, always keep in mind that you want to create a portfolio. Therefore, you should check for other possibilities of IPR forms. Once you have done the patenting aspect, immediately start looking for marketing your invention. Do not stop at just applying for a patent. Look for who can market your, who can be a potential market, who is a commercial entity who can take the invention ahead. Do not limit your patent filing to only India. You should actively seek foreign filings. Have a little knowledge. If you have decided, say, for example, that you're going to file in the US patent office as well, then have a little background, you know, knowledge of the US Patent Act, or tell your attorney to advise you on it. There may be some claims which are not allowed in India. For example, I told you method of treatment is not allowed in India. However, method of treatment kind of claims is allowable in the US. Therefore, repurposed drugs can be protected by method of treatment claims in the US. So if you have done any repurposing activity, you may not get a patent protection in India, but you can certainly go to the US patent office and seek patent protection there. Similarly, use kind of claims are not protectable in India. India protects only products and processes, but uses are protectable in Europe. So now you, if you're looking at new use, say remdesivir was known to be an antiviral drug. However, its use in this particular strain of coronavirus, the SARS-CoV, is not protectable in India because it is a new use of a known substance. However, use of remdesivir to make a medicament to treat SARS-CoV infections is protectable in Europe. Therefore, make it a point to explore all these various protectable aspects that can come out of pursuing foreign filings. And then, as I told you before, determine your market and start marketing your IPs. There are forums that are available who help you to market your IPs. There is a slide in this particular presentation itself. You can take note of these kind of organizations and seek their help to market your intellectual properties. And always make it a point to create a portfolio. Never create just standalone IPs, because there are other aspects of intellectual properties, you know, whether there is a freedom to operate, whether you're infringing somebody else's IP, all these will come into play when you have standalone IPs. However, if you've created a portfolio, then you have a much stronger value to that portfolio, as well as a much stronger attractiveness to it, such that a commercial entity will come and start discussing with you for either licensing or assigning those IPs to them. So standalone IPs sometimes do get created and you should have them. However, try and see how well you can create a portfolio and a bouquet of IPRs. Having said all this, the next question is, when should you seek the protection? So if you have come up with an idea whether it is a good suggestion to do idea patenting. This is a very, very common question that most of us have. I've come up with this idea, ma'am. Do you think it is patentable? This is a question that many people ask me. And to me, it is not a very good stage at which you would want to seek patent protection. Finally, in your patent application, you have to establish novelty, utility, and industry and non-obviousness. So if you want to show that your invention has usefulness and it is industrially applicable, then you have to work it in the laboratory. You have to see whether your idea is doing exactly what it was envisaged to do, whether it is solving the problem that you have come across, and whether it is the ideal solution to the problem which can satisfy patentability criteria. All this can be established only by way of experimental data. Therefore, idea patenting is not a very good idea. At least have one set of experimental results and then file for a provisional patent application, and then go back and file the complete within a year by working out the other aspects and nuances of the invention in the laboratory within that 12 months that the patent act gives you. So not at the stage of idea, but certainly when the initial successful experimental data is obtained, you can immediately go and apply for a patent protection. Now, what do you mean by determining the boundaries of your invention? So what happens is, invariably, when we get some idea that a particular invention works, we would want to go and apply for a patent protection. But why you would want to not limit the boundaries of your invention is, you should try and accommodate as many obvious extensions of your invention as possible in your own application. Now, why would you want to do that? Because if somebody comes up with an obvious extension of your invention, then that person does not get a patent for his invention because it is obvious and it doesn't satisfy the requirement of inventive step. However, when you go to commercialize your invention, okay, suppose you have not protected that obvious extension in your own patent application, then the person who has made the non-obvious extension has the freedom to work that invention in the market without patent protection. Okay, so you lose out on the possibility of commercializing your invention by way of that particular entity. Okay, he has worked around your invention. He has found a way out, and he has now found that he need not pay you licensing fee even though you have patent protection for an obvious invention. So therefore, it is important that you determine the metes and bounds, or as we say, the boundaries of your invention well enough such that all obvious extensions are included in it and nobody can work around your invention very easily. Okay, I've explained you the provisional versus complete. I've explained novelty, utility, and non-obviousness. Now, what exactly are the rights that you're getting? You can prevent others from manufacturing, offering for sale, selling, using, or importing an invention. This is what patent rights are all about. And you can do this for 20 years of time for disclosing your invention to the patent office. And it is those inventions which are products or processes and which are novel, inventive, or non-obvious, which can enjoy these rights for 20 years. So these are the rights that are vested on you by way of the Patent Act. And therefore, to prevent somebody from working around these rights, you need to determine all those aspects of your invention which are patent eligible and cover it in your patent application. Now, when you are doing all this, it is important for you to perform due diligence exercises. That is, you do your prior art search. You see who else is there in the market with similar kind of products. How close are their solutions to your invention? Is it going to impact on the patentability or the marketability or the attractiveness or the commercial aspects of your invention? You should be able to determine all this by performing the necessary due diligence exercises. Now, once you have applied for a patent, nowadays the key word is to collaborate. You cannot do everything yourself. You need collaborators for various, aspects of taking your invention ahead. Now, when you're collaborating, it is very important for you to understand certain things. What is the memorandum of understanding that you're signing between yourself and the collaborator? What are the rights given to you in that? What are the rights rested on your collaborator? Okay, you need to understand that what is the background IPs that you have already sought, which is in your name. What is it he's collaborating with you for? And if there are future IPs that are generated, will it be jointly held or will it be held only under your name? Suppose you're paying him off for the services, then he is not eligible for patent protection. So you have to understand these aspects very clearly. You should, you know, commit all kinds of collaborations only after you have signed confidentiality agreements or what are called non-disclosure agreements. So confidentiality agreements or non-disclosure agreements bind both the parties to say that you cannot disclose the invention. There can be a tenure to it. You can say you cannot disclose it maybe for the next few years till you eventually conclude the research and look at the marketable aspects of it. Then you can even have material transfer agreements. For example, you have found something, you have, say for example, you have bioengineered an organism and you're transferring this material to a commercial entity. Then that will also go through what is called a material transfer agreement. It may have commercial terms, it may have non-commercial terms, it can have milestone related payment terms. All this have to be well understood, and it is always good when you're doing these kind of execution of agreements to have your university's legal self advising you on it. Okay, so eventually if you have patentable inventions, actively seek commercial partners or see if you can establish a startup around it, see where can the funding come from it, and you also can obtain IPRs in foreign domains. So don't miss out on timelines and deadlines for seeking protection in other domains. These are all time-bound activities. So it is always good for your IPR cell in your university to be actively involved when you are seeking patent protection or protection for any other form of IPRs. So moving on further, you know, while there are several needs that you need to fulfill, you also should not miss out on market needs. So you have to understand legally where you stand, that you have to comply to the other laws that are there in the company, in the country. You have to seek approvals as and when required. You will need to have your own team building exercises, understand where the competition is coming from, how to scale up your invention, how will you produce it, how will you market it, what are the various testings to be done. And while you're doing all these activities, always keep an eye on the fact that you need to do a complete review and a continuous audit of the IPs that you're generating while doing these processes. You know, several times when you're scaling up or when you're doing, you know, conducting something at the production level or even marketing your product, you all very well know that IPRs get generated even at these stages. How do new users come up? Because there is a post-marketing surveillance that is conducted by the organization. And what the clinicians share is what gives you an idea of the possible new use of a known substance. So even at those stages, you know, IPRs can be generated. While typically producing something, if there is a problem you come across on a large scale and you find a novel solution to it, maybe that can be held as a know-how or that can be held as a patent itself. So at all these stages, you can have potential to create IP, and therefore a continuous review of all of it is also called for. Okay. So I particularly put up this slide because collaboration is where the world is going today. And especially if you're in an academic scenario, then collaboration is the, you know, jingle. And if you are looking at the typical pharma drugs that have been introduced in the market in the last couple of decades or so, then most of the antibodies are, you know, monoclonal antibodies are listed here. However, this is true of even other drugs. And you can see that it's all been invented by a particular academic institution and eventually commercialized by a pharmaceutical company. So the topmost entry in this table is molnupiravir, and this is indicated in red because this drug was, you know, it's a small molecule that was invented by Emory University. However, Merck is currently conducting clinical trials for the use of molnupiravir against the coronavirus. So this is one of the drugs that is being studied now, even after remdesivir had attained success at the marketplace. This is a much smaller drug with a huge potential to be administered orally, while remdesivir and tocilizumab, which is the other monoclonal body that is used for, you know, this pandemic, are to be administered only by the parenteral route. So to overcome those challenges, you now have a drug that has a potential to treat the virus as well as a potential for oral administration. And Merck has taken this ahead. So it is only by way of these academia industry collaborations that these molecules are seeing the marketplace. So that is a buzzword today. And I put in the slide specifically to highlight to you all the possible schemes and proposals that are available by the government, Department of Science and Technology and Department of Biotechnology. I'm sure many of you would have seen this as a screenshot or would have got it in your WhatsApp groups. But just to highlight the fact that funding is very well available. Okay, throughout 2021, you have calls for various proposals. And further to this, okay, further to what the government is offering, there are also exclusive schemes and initiatives and programs that are run by these particular departments, which are meant for IP filing itself. Okay, and also for those products of the schemes, like Inspire is a scheme that is run by DST, but the product that you come up with eventually at the end of it is, you know, eligible for patent protection under the scheme itself. So you can have this as, you know, schemes that are available for seeking IP protection, both for national as well as for foreign filings. So you have the BIRAC or the Ignition schemes, the big schemes that are available by BIRAC, which is a company that has been floated by DBT. I'm sure each one of you as pharmacists are very well aware of the various schemes under BIRAC for geriatric medicines, for pediatric medicine. They have a focus on antimicrobial resistance. So if you have, you know, particular research work being done in these areas of technology, then you should look up the BIRAC website to see what are the various schemes available there. You have the Atal Innovation Scheme, you have the various, national and university-based innovation councils, which have schemes for funding IP protection. Then you have NBM, or the National Biopharma Mission, again under the flagship of BIRAC. The National Biopharma Mission particularly focused on new drug discovery and taking biopharmaceuticals ahead. So again, a funding as for research as well as for IP offered by the government scheme. You have proof of concept schemes or the POC funds. You have connections through the Pune network of VVC and angel funding. I've just given Pune as an example because I am based here. I'm sure many cities around the country have these kind of networks now. You have the various IP facilitation centers which provide IP services at very highly subsidized costs for individual as well as academic and industrial inventors and applicants. Then you have the National Research and Development Council, which is a very useful source of advice and a useful source for funding IP. So there are several fora through which you can seek both funding for research as well as for IP. And if you're looking to commercialize the IP or the technology that you have generated, then you have the TechXN, which is operated out of Venture Center at Pune in India. And it is supported by the NBM that I just spoke of, the National Biopharma Mission. So they, as a hub, facilitate technology transfer from non-commercial entities such as individuals or academia to commercial entities. They facilitate the transfer. They also have legal advisory people. They have IP advisory people on board. So it is a very good resource that you can put forth. Check up the website of Venture Center. You'll get more details there. You have the IDMA bulletin. IDMA is something that we're all familiar with. They have a regular publication of ready to commercialize technology, so you can use that platform. Many technology commercializers nowadays use social media. You know, they use Instagram and LinkedIn and all, very, very widely used, not only to seek employment, but also to seek commercial partners for your technology. And you also have private organizations and service providers. My own company does this kind of work. So you can contact any of these once you have your technology progress to the level that it can be commercialized. So now I come to that part of my talk, which is to do with IPR portfolio planning, with particular focus on academic institutions, particularly the kind of pharmacy colleges that most of you are part of. So I have come up with this particular idea that you can actually create a very, very valuable IPR portfolio by conducting research at your college level or at your university level. So this is in line with the way in which the industry creates IPR portfolio. It is not something extremely unheard of by any of you, but I'm just going to take you through a short journey on how it can be done at an academic level. And you as passionate researchers and, you know, people who take pharmaceutical sciences to the next level in terms of research are certainly going to associate with this idea. And I'm hoping that at least a few of the institutions that you people belong to will take this idea forward, and we will see a lot of output in terms of portfolio creation in the coming years. So the next part of this talk will be on the creation of the portfolio. And to those skeptics who think that this is not an idea that will work, I also have a slide to conclude which says that there are certain, you know, indicators and events that have occurred over a period of time, which says that things can happen better in the future. So let's first plunge into the portfolio creation and then look at the downside of it. Okay. So typically, if you're looking at an academic institution, these are the departments that you have. So you have the chem, you have the cognosy, the ecology, the zootics, the analysis, and the micro and biochem departments. So these are the major departments that you have in your academic institute. And the portfolio creation that we are envisaging is going to involve researchers, students, and mentors in each of these sections or departments. So that is why it is going to be a portfolio relating to the academic institute itself at large. Okay, so this is going to be like a case study that I've taken up. I am putting forth an invention which is possible, which is radical, new, and absolutely something that is unheard of in terms of a new chemical entity that you have isolated from a natural source. So I have looked at a new chemical entity here, while you can also have potentially an improvement over an existing entity that is known also. So let's look at it from the perspective that the following slides, it could be an entity that is already there in the public domain. Okay. So if you are talking of a new chemical entity that you have isolated, say from a natural source, so you can have the process of isolation, the elucidation of its structure, and the assaying of its activity as the part of the first invention that you have made. And you have the involvement of all these departments, the chem, the analytical, the ecology, and the cognosy departments here. So you have already a couple of inventions, though I have not classified it. However, you have the new chemical entity, the process of getting it, and what can be its activity. So all these can form part of the first invention that you have made. And then what will you, how will you take it ahead? So once you have a new chemical entity, okay, you can have a look at, the chemistry guys can have a look at what are the analogs, what are the derivatives that can be prepared out of them. And then you have a process of preparing them, and then you assay them for activity, and you eventually develop various dosage forms for them. Okay, so here you begin with the zootics guys because you have dosages being developed. You anyways have the involvement of the chemistry and then analysis and the ecology paper here. Moving on further, the zootics department can have stable dosage forms being developed. Then you can have line extensions in terms of other dosage forms. You have injectables, syrups, granules, etc., etc. You can also have them looking at, you know, various novel drug delivery systems or release profile, controlled release profile kind of products that they can think of. All those can be part of the next course of inventive activity that you can pursue. Then you go back to the chemistry of the new chemical entity. You look at whether there can be possible isomers. They could be positive isomers, or they could be, you know, enantiomers, or you have racemic mixtures, or you can have diastereomers, and then you have to resolve them. So you can have chemical or biological methods of resolving. So you again have a huge amount of farm chem and process chemistry and analysis and assaying. You have to assay again because you don't know which is the active enantiomer or active isomer. And then once you have all of those, okay, then you can have the single isomer being protected or the single enantiomer being protected, and then you're working on its activity. So you are reducing the toxicity. So you have the pharmacological inputs coming in there. And then you're looking at its metabolic aspects, whether you can have prodrugs out of it, whether you can combine them with any other drug, or you can, you know, look at this stage itself, look at whether it is combining with any other receptor in the body, and you can propose a second use of them. So, you know, you can have all these inventions coming out of these departments in your institute itself. And then a very critical aspect of, you know, a drug is its impurity level, whether it is coming from an intermediate in the earlier step, or whether it is coming from the natural source itself and you have not been able to eliminate it through the various processing you have done. The isolation process is giving it with a certain impurity profile itself. So you can have a claim on the new chemical entity with the percentage of impurity in it. Then you can have the process people working on how to reduce the impurity. So you have process chemistry coming there. So you have improvements in the drug itself by ways of, you know, crystallizing it in a certain way such that you have the impurity reduced, or the crystallization technique resulting in new polymers or co-crystals. So you can have more and more entities that you're developing. I do agree that when I discussed Section 3 of the Indian Patent Act, I told that new forms and new, you know, applications and new uses of known substances are not eligible for patent protection. However, if you recollect, I also specified that Section 3 is relevant only to India. So only in India, they cannot be patented unless you demonstrate enhanced efficacy. However, you can patent it in foreign domains. So if you have a novel polymer, which say, for example, reduces the toxicity of the particular drug, then there is novelty, inventive step, and industrial application, and therefore it is eligible for patent protection in foreign countries. If you can show enhanced efficacy, then it is eligible for patent protection in India also. So you should pursue all these aspects of patenting also. And the progress of your research, once you have found a new drug, or if you're working on an existing drug, the progress of the research to find new polymorphic materials or new co-crystals or new salts or ethers or esters or complexes, which can improve the taste, odor, dissolution, or bioavailability of the drug, or if you can control the size to improve the bioavailability, all these aspects can also be inventions which can eventually result in the creation of the portfolio that you're envisaging. So you can have the you know, contributions from your SUTICs and analysis people, and you can have these further inventions that can be created from your own resource persons in your own academic institute. Another issue that has come across by way of the fact that we are increasingly dependent on countries like China, who give us key starting materials or valuable intermediates, then working on these aspects on a new drug or an existing drug can again become further inventions, or they can be new inventions in a new portfolio. So you can start working on how to obtain key starting materials or how key intermediates can be synthesized in your laboratory. So you can have your chemistry and your analysis people working on these aspects of you know, drugs, and you can have product and process claims and inventions around them. And intermediates sometimes themselves are absolutely new compounds. They have never been disclosed prior to the time that you invented, and even a cipher search does not reveal anything similar to the intermediate that you have come across, which eventually is giving you a very valuable drug. So the intermediate itself can be patented as a product. You can have a claim on the compound. It is novel, non-obvious, and useful. It is useful because it is giving you a drug that is very well established in literature, but the intermediate can by itself enjoy patent protection. So you again have an addition to your portfolio. And if somebody wants to synthesize that drug via this new route that you're proposing, then this can contribute to the commercial aspects of your portfolio. So by way of these various inventions that you're creating, okay, you can actually have an entire portfolio built similar to an innovator drug company. This can be done even at the academic level. So what you're trying to do is you are going into the depth of a particular new drug or a known drug. You are going into the depth of it to look at inventions which can be built around them. Okay. So if you have a drug and you have a dissolution problem, you're looking at various ways in which it can be resolved. So while the Sutics people are working, say, for example, on particle control and, you know, excipients that can be added and a novel formulation that can be made, which can have an effect on the dissolution, the chemistry guy, you know, experts are looking at how the molecule itself can be crystallized or the molecule itself can be synthesized in a manner in which you can have co-crystals which have dissolution enhanced. Or you go back and look at other aspects of the molecule. You can see if you can have different salts or different esters of it made, and then that can improve the problem that you're, you know, or it can resolve the problem that you're facing. So within an organization, with the kind of expertise that you all have, with the kind of passion you all have for research, and the students that you have who can, you know, actually do the experimental part, you can collaborate internally. You can have teams formed internally which can resolve these issues and create a valuable portfolio of intellectual property rights for your own organization. So here you don't only have inventions, or you don't only have inventions which are going to be patented, but say, for example, you're looking at, you know, the particle size, or you're looking at a particular analytical technique to determine the impurity or to profile the impurity, then those can enjoy know-how or copyright protection. Then if you're, you know, kind of inventing around a device which is there to deliver the drug in the manner in which you desire. So if your solution to the problem of particle size is through, is by way of a particular design of a device, which will, you know, deliver the drug in a particular particle size, then that device can enjoy design protection. So you can have an entire portfolio built in this manner, and it need not be that it has to come out of a research activity by a corporate. It can certainly come out of a research activity pursued at the university level. So this is one technique by way of which you can have an IPR portfolio planning for pharmaceuticals and created by the pharmacists and the expertise available in-house. So eventually, of course, as Peter Drucker, the famous marketing expert, said, the test of an innovation, after all, lies not in its novelty or its scientific content or its cleverness, but actually lies in its success in the marketplace. So you need to have need-based solutions which can have success in the marketplace. So when you do all these kind of inventive activities, you're certainly going to have commercial partners who will eventually take it to the marketable stage. So if you were to look at it as creation of a portfolio which can have an eventual commercial consequence of it and the success at the marketplace, then you can certainly work on creating the portfolio like that. Now, having said all this, okay, I put in this slide particularly, this is where I conclude my presentation, but I'm going to take a little time on all this because I have listed a few historical events. I have listed a few initiatives taken by the government of India. I have also listed a few landmark cases in terms of pharmaceutical patenting that has occurred in our country in the last couple of decades. So this is for all of us to realize that we are in a dynamic world, and we as a country, even though we are listed as a third world country and we are not into pharmaceutical, you know, drug discovery, but we are more of, you know, known as a hub for manufacturing and for only doing research to take a known molecule ahead. There are several indications to, you know, state that we can move away from that image of our country and can even be recognized as a country that is involved in drug discovery. So just to highlight what I put as bullets here, the, you know, years 1970 to 2005 has been a journey in terms of pharmaceutical patenting. Okay, so 1970 was when the Patent Act was amended to exclude product patenting, while 2005 is the year in which it was brought back into the Patent Act to include product patenting in pharmaceuticals. So in 1970, when it was excluded, we burst into the international scenario in terms of a nation that was recognized to work around products and to produce products in a very economically significant manner. So we came to know as the pharmacy of the world, the generic manufacturer of the world. However, once we came into the TRIPS regime, and in 2005, when product patenting was allowed in India, we found that we have to make amendments to the way in which we conduct research. Amendments are made to the way in which patent protection will be provided to pharmaceutical products. And that resulted in the insertion actually of the Section 3D that we were looking at. That is, new forms of known substances not eligible for patent protection unless enhanced therapeutic efficacy is demonstrated, which is the case of imatinib mesylate, a drug that is administered to patients suffering from chronic myelogenous leukemia. This is a drug that is invented and marketed by Novartis with the brand name Gleevec. And Gleevec actually is for the beta crystalline polymer B of imatinib. And being a polymorphic form, this patent application was rejected by the Indian Patent Office on the basis of Section 3D, because it was a new form of the known drug imatinib, which was patented way back in 1993 by Novartis in many countries in the world. So when they came to India and applied for a product patent, Indian Patent Office said that it is a new form of the known substance imatinib. They showed that particular prior art to Novartis. They said on the basis of this, we are rejecting this application. However, Novartis appealed against the rejection. Eventually, the matter went to Supreme Court, and in a landmark ruling, the Supreme Court opined that unless you show enhanced therapeutic efficacy, that is, that the drug works in a patient in need of the drug. So you have to actually show it in patients who are suffering from that particular form of cancer, that the beta crystalline polymorphic form of imatinib mesylate is better than imatinib itself or imatinib salt form, that is imatinib mesylate, another crystalline form. So unless that is demonstrated by Novartis, they are not eligible for patent protection. So this landmark judgment then resulted in patents being filed with the data necessary to overcome Section 3D objections. Okay, so I will come to that a little later, which is, you know, shown by way of tofacitinib in by Pfizer. But in between the tofacitinib judgment, which came as late as in 2020 December, there were a couple of more events that occurred. One was the compulsory license issued by the government of India against Bayer, who were the patentee of sorafenib, because the drug was not made available to Indians at an economic cost. So Indian government put its foot down and said that NATCO, which was the applicant for the compulsory licensing, okay, demonstrated or could show through data that sorafenib by Bayer was not available to the Indian population, even though they had patented it in numbers that they required and at a price that is convenient for an Indian cancer patient to buy it and use it for their treatment. So this was a landmark judgment again by the government, because even though we have product patent regime in India, it established the fact that when it comes to the customer or the patient in need of a drug, then the government will certainly intervene even though it is a patented drug. Mind you, compulsory licensing are provisions in the Patent Act, in every Patent Act in every country in the world. It is not unique only to India. It is part of an international agreement signed by various countries, and it is enshrined in the Patent Act of every country in the world. It is not unique only to India. Similarly, sorafenib also was the subject matter of another case which was judged by the Delhi High Court, which said that unlike US, where patent of pharmaceuticals and the functioning or the decisions of the Food and Drug Administration of US have a linkage, that is called a patent linkage, a linkage between FDA and patent office for pharmaceutical patents. Such kind of linkages will not be provided in India. So this was another landmark judgment which said that these are two independent bodies and their functioning will not be linked. Okay, so what this basically said was, if there are delays in the grant of a marketing license by the FDA, then the patent term will not be eligible for an extension. This was the bottom line of not linking the patent act, patent office functioning and the functioning of the FDA. Okay, so this was another two events that took place. And then as late as in 2020, we saw the tofacitinib application granted by the Indian Patent Office, because out of the four diastereomers of tofacitinib that Pfizer had applied for in terms of patent protection, they could demonstrate that one particular diastereomer had enhanced efficacy in treating rheumatoid arthritis for which tofacitinib is intended. So they could actually provide data in their patent application and in the submissions that they made later to the patent office that the particular diastereomer, even though it is a new form of a known substance, does possess enhanced efficacy. So what was, you know, told by the Supreme Court in the imatinib mesylate case was fulfilled by Pfizer, and therefore it was granted a patent. Similarly, if you look at the diclofenac injection troika case, which was also judged as late as in 2020, this was a very well-known product. However, Troika, which is an Indian company, mind you, did come up with a formulation. Diclofenac injection, again, is a very well-known formulation, even prior to their application for patent protection in around 2005, I think. Even then, they could get a patent granted because with the kind of excipients they used, they were able to overcome several issues of dissolution of diclofenac and with regard to the pain experienced by the patient when the injection is administered. So another landmark case that we should take note of. And finally, coming to the antiviral drugs, sofosbuvir and remdesivir, I have particularly pointed these out in this particular presentation because these are two drugs which did not get patent protection in India. Okay, sofosbuvir was rejected under Section 3D by the Indian Patent Office. Remdesivir is patent protected in India, however, not for treating the novel SARS coronavirus, the current pandemic one. Okay, so these are two examples of non-patented invention, however, enjoying supreme market presence and commercial success because of the fact that Gilead Sciences could come up with new strategies to exploit the know-how that they have by way of licensing it to commercial entities who are Indian companies. So in the case of sofosbuvir, Gilead licensed the know-how to, I think, about 10 Indian companies who then eventually marketed the drug to treat hepatitis. Okay, so sofosbuvir is a drug that can treat hepatitis with minimal toxicity to liver cells, and therefore it has a huge benefit in terms of patient convenience. However, it was obvious and falling under Section 3D. So it did not have patent protection, but enjoyed huge commercial success because of Gilead's marketing strategy. Similarly, for remdesivir, when Gilead realized that they cannot have a patent protection for this drug, they therefore licensed it to Indian companies, and we all know the success of remdesivir in the Indian market. So it need not be patents all the way. It can also be know-how, and it can also be smart marketing strategies. So your portfolio can be a combination of all these things. That is why I spoke of quasi-intellectual properties also, which you create, which you can protect, and you will eventually commercialize and gain financial benefits out of them. So having said all that, I also want to take a minute to talk about the various initiatives taken by the Government of India and the patent offices. Today, you don't look at 7 to 8 years to get a patent. Patent office has speeded up its process to the extent that you can get a patent if you opt for accelerated processes by paying extra fee even within a year. And even if you don't want to pay extra fee, within 3 years, your patent's judgment will come from the patent office. That is the speed at which they are functioning today. It has become extremely efficient. They have become extremely transparent. Everything is put up at the patent office website. And all these initiatives are working in favor of academic institutions, individual inventors, and startups who are seeking patent protection for their valuable intellectual outputs. And there are several schemes also provided for women applicants, for startups, and for government-funded institutions in terms of reduced fee and so on and so forth. You can find all these by way of amendments and gazette notifications, and also at the Indian Patent Office website. So with this, I conclude my talk, and I hope the last 2 hours that you have spent with me have been useful, and I look forward to seeing a creation of healthy and commercially attractive patent portfolios across various academic institutes in India. Thank you so much for patient hearing, and I'm open for any questions that you may have.
Yes, ma'am, there is a question in chat box by Punk. What is the scope for pharma graduate in IPR domain?
Okay, so I many times have, when I talk, when I know there are going to be students, I have it as a slide in my presentation. Today, however, since I was addressing academicians and researchers, I didn't do that. There is a tremendous scope for pharma practitioners in the domain of IP. I'll just put it across as two major bullets. One, I would say, what are the skill sets that you require? And two, what is the avenues open to you? So in terms of skill set, an excellent command over current pharmaceutical technologies. So that can be by way of you gaining knowledge, through reading, or by, having a degree, the highest possible degree. Many people who are in this domain are PhD and LLBs or LLMs. So that is the kind of people we are seeing coming into this field of intellectual property rights. So an excellent command over the technology, good communication skills, good, a very patient, ability to listen and to read and understand. These are the skill sets you require. On the other hand, if you're looking at the avenues open to you, there are several law firms who have pharmaceutical companies as their clients, and therefore require pharmaceutical graduates who are at least patent agent or law graduates along with that. And then you can also go into the IPR cells of the pharma corporates. Though some of them recruit, people who are working in their regulatory or R&D departments, however, you can enter, you can laterally shift from those departments into the IPR cell also. Most corporates have their own IPR cells, so that is another interesting avenue. Then there are, as I told you, the patent office itself, which is continuously recruiting patent examiners. So there are advertisements put up by them. You have to go through an exam, and I think a Viva Voice. They also trained you excellently. In fact, the training given by the Indian Patent Office is one of the best in the world. So you would become a very good resource person for them, a very valuable patent examiner. And just as a matter of sharing between you and me, there are many patent examiners who then move on to, the law firms or to the IPR cells of corporates later, because they are very valuable in terms of understanding the Indian Patent Act as well as the domain of pharmaceuticals. So you have all these options open to you where you can pursue your career. Currently, we don't have too many academic courses being offered in IPR. It is only one of the optional subjects. So academia is not a place, but if innovation cells and universities grow to the extent that is, envisaged by the government of India today, then certainly those kind of, IP cells and innovation cells will seek expertise in the domain of pharma, along with a good knowledge of law, as well as particularly Patent Act related issues in the pharmaceutical field. So these are the various avenues that will be open to you.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am, for giving your valuable insights on basics of IPR and planning an IPR portfolio and proposals for patent portfolio, which included different types of IPR, Patent Act 1970, patent application and grant procedure, IP management. Ma'am, I'm sure your address will help our delegates in IPR and regulatory field. Ma'am, please kindly accept this virtual bouquet on behalf of convener Dr. P.D. Chaudhary, Principal of PS Modern College of Pharmacy, Nigri, Pune, and Coordinator of STTP, Dr. Bhushan Pimpre Sir, Associate Professor at PS Modern College of Pharmacy, Nigri, Pune, as a token of gratitude. Ma'am, please kindly
accept. Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Please kindly accept the certificate from PS Modern College of Pharmacy, Nigri, Pune, as a token of appreciation. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you once again, ma'am, and thank you, Modern College, and particularly Professor Chaudhary, for giving me this opportunity to interact with all of you. I again say I sincerely hope that this has been a useful session. I had somebody raising their hand. Do you want to say something, Dr. Kuspe? No? Okay, thank you so much, ma'am, if that is a...
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. Bye-bye.
So I declare that our today's session of STTP is concluded. Tomorrow we will continue with the next technical session at 11 a.m. Tomorrow's first session will be conducted by Professor Dr. Vandana Patravade, Professor of Pharmaceutics, Department of Pharmaceutical Sciences and Technology, Institute of Chemical Technology, Mumbai, on topic Strategies for Effective Research Grant Writing. Second session will be conducted by Dr. Ashok Panda, MD, Research Officer at CARIHD Bhubaneswar under CCRAS, Member of AYUSH, Government of India, on topic Scope of Pharma Professionals in AYUSH. And third session will be conducted by Dr. Remit Dias, HOD of Government College of Pharmacy, Karad, on topic Rules of Effective Teaching Learning Process. All delegates are informed that the link for today's quiz will be available to you on your registered email ID and MCOP STTP Telegram group at 4 p.m. All delegates are requested to actively attend all the sessions as your attendance is being monitored continuously by our technical team. Link for tomorrow's session will be shared on your registered email ID and MCOP STTP Telegram group. Thank you all the participants and eminent speakers. Have a good day.